Okay, I just laid my hands on the new AMD Ryzen 3000 series and the Radeon RX 5700. Today seems to be AMD's undeniable moment of glory. We just tested the brand new Ryzen 3000 CPU series and also the brand new Radeon RX 5700 GPU series. It's a strange moment, but that's how AMD was in the last few years. It's like they woke up from a long sleep and said that enough is enough. I said it's strange because every time they released good CPUs, they had very weak graphic cards and vice versa. But not this time, and they are facing two formidable competitors, actually the biggest in the world, Intel and Nvidia. On the CPU front, there's nothing else to prove further for AMD. They simply defeated Intel on their own turf. Better technology, better price, better CPUs. No matter how hard the blue team supporters are trying to say it's otherwise. At least on the desktop CPU side. Intel just failed to make the transition to 7 nanometers in time, and people were just tired of endless incremental updates from one generation to another. Meanwhile, AMD processors got better and better since the first Ryzen generation up to this day, when we finally met the first 7 nanometer desktop CPU in the world. When talking about the graphic cards, things are a bit more complicated. Nvidia launched a new generation just last autumn. I'm talking about the 2000 series. At the time, AMD's RX 500 series was already long in teeth. The RX 500 series went through a lot, the crypto mining hysteria, the tough competition, and so on. But it always kept one important advantage, that being the price. And it was an advantage that Nvidia mostly lacked, and still is, at least on their most recent 2000 series. The old RX 500 series is still able to put up a good fight when it comes to bang for the buck, even in the face of the much newer GTX 1650 or GTX 1660. And on top of that, Nvidia just launched a few days ago an updated 2000 series, the Super. But this time AMD was ready with a brand new 5700. That being said, let's get down to business, see what's what, and figure out how the new products will stack against the competition. Let's start with the CPUs. First things first, the newest Ryzen CPUs is built on 7 nanometer process and supports PCI Express 4.0, two terms that represent the future of this industry and that make this launch a truly historic one. Also, AMD is keen to provide better single-thread performance, while increasing the multi-thread power too. The new architecture continues what the older Zen and Zen Plus started. Zen 2 brings various improvements like higher chip bandwidth, better security protocols, and the most important of all, an increase of up to 15% in the IPC, instructions per cycle, in comparison with the top-tier model of last year, AMD Ryzen 7 2700X. We'll see up to 34% gaming performance gains. AMD Ryzen 9 3900X, alongside its more powerful partner, the Ryzen 9, 3950X are AMD's answer for the Intel Core i9 series and offers a very efficient choice for content creators and for those who need a lot of raw processing power. Ryzen 9 3900X is a beastly CPU starring 12 cores and the SMT technology that offers 24 threads. That combined with a base clock of 3.8 GHz and boost up to 4.6 and 6 plus 64 MB cache L2 plus L3 make the CPU the perfect contender for the i9-9900K at a similar price tag. You also have to keep in mind the 105 watts TDP and the included AMD Wraith Prism RGB cooler that keeps the CPU in leash with no big trouble. What about the AMD Ryzen 7 3700X? If the 9 series is tailored for productivity, Ryzen 7 is AMD's go-to solution for gaming. Ryzen 7 3700X is 2700X's successor and sports 8 cores and 16 threads, 4 plus 32 MB cache, and a base clock of 3.6 GHz that goes up to 4.4 while in boost. This combination makes it stand out from the crowd, but for me, the main selling point is the 65 watts TDP and also the price, because you will spend no more than $329 on this CPU. And here's the platform we used in testing those CPUs. AMD Ryzen 9 3900X and AMD Ryzen 7 3700X, ROG Crosshair 8 Hero Wi-Fi, G-Skill Trident Z Royal Gold 16GB 3600 MHz dual channel, AMD Radeon RX 5700XT, Aorus NVMe Gen 4 2TB SSD, and the source, a Seasonic Prime 850 Ultra Titanium. For getting the best out of those CPUs, I used a selection of benchmarks and games. For comparison, I use the Intel Core i9-9900K, the biggest threat from Intel, and AMD's own Ryzen 7 2700X, the titan of the last gen Ryzen. I didn't overclock any of the CPUs, and for the AMD ones, I used the Wraith Prism RGB cooler. As you can see from the benchmark results, Ryzen 9 3900X is a beast of a CPU, putting the Core i9-9900K to its place. Also, the Ryzen 7 3700X is a very unexpected surprise, keeping a very little distance from the 9900K, while having a much lower price tag. For example, in Blender benchmark, the Ryzen 9 3900X finished the test in close to 11 minutes, while its rival 9900K struggled to finish it in 15 minutes. In Cinebench R20, Ryzen 9 3900X had a single core result of 512 points, a perfect match to the 9900K, while in multi-core, the Ryzen topped 7127 against the 4953 of Intel's. What about gaming? Well, this is where the biggest surprise of them all occurred. We all knew why the Core i9-9900K is a great choice for a gaming machine, no doubt about that. But nobody prepared me for the results of the Ryzen 7 3700X, which managed to closely follow the Intel CPU while beating AMD's own 3900X in some games. The Ryzen 7 3700X was the star of the comparison. In Metro Exodus, had an average of 171 FPS against 175 for 9900K and 169 for the 3900X. In Odyssey, there were 99 FPS for 3700X compared to the 101 for the Intel and 104 for the 3900X. Temperatures were fine, maybe a tad too high on the Ryzen 9 3900X using the stock cooler. But this is not a very big problem, as in full load the CPU never got over 90 degrees Celsius, with room temperatures well over 20 degrees. Not the biggest issue here, as nobody in its right mind will rock the stock cooler on this beast while using 100% of its power. On the other side, the Ryzen 7 3700X was better suited for this cooling solution, as it never went over 60 degrees Celsius while gaming. The third gen Ryzen is a big success in my opinion, offering a lot of power at an affordable price tag. They come as a real upgrade over the last gen Ryzen CPUs and deliver good performance to match Intel. Productivity-wise, the Ryzen 9 3900X was a monster, beating the Core i9-9900K by a mile in some apps, but for me, the biggest surprise of them all was the Ryzen 7 3700X, which delivered similar performance to the 9900K both in gaming and productivity tasks, while sporting a very good price. Keep in mind that it also has a reliable cooling solution, so this is already becoming an unfair fight. Okay, enough chit-chat about the CPUs, because we were forgetting about the other important part of this launch, the graphic cards. It is fair to say that AMD offered decent GPUs in the recent years, with the RX 580 and RX 590 being good budget offerings. This time around, though, AMD is entering the high-end market with the introduction of three new models: Radeon RX 5700, RX 5700 XT, and the RX 5700 XT 50th Anniversary Edition. I tested the first two and I want to have a little talk about them. The new Radeon GPUs changed the rules of the game using the same 7-nanometer fabrication process as the 3rd-gen Ryzen CPUs and the new RDNA architecture. They also sport a healthy 8GB GDDR6 memory and the new Navi cores. Alongside those nice specs, AMD is providing some nice software improvements like the Radeon Image Sharpening that sharpens the images distorted or blurred out by various in-game filters, the Radeon Anti-Lag technology that is improving esports titles' performance and brings supports for up to 4K and 144Hz through DisplayPort 1.4. Both models require two additional power connectors, a 6-pin and an 8-pin. They both have very high TDPs, with the RX 5700 requiring 185 watts to run and the RX 5700 XT sucking a huge 225 watts from the socket at full load, without taking overclock into consideration. That is no good news from my perspective, as they will be a bit hard to cool, but we'll see in the future how the lads at Sapphire, Asus, AMSI or Gigabyte will manage to keep all those degrees down. I like good-looking components, and I see the personal computer as any other long-term investment. You get a new car, you like the idea of getting some new rims for it. The same with the PC, I think about some fancy fans or some braided cables. That being said, I'm a bit disappointed by AMD. The Radeon RX 5700 is like the 2019 edition of the Radeon HD 5770, and it even has the same turbine cooler. Isn't that old? A 1mm aluminum plate would have been great, even just for fine looks, if not for cooling. On the other side, the RX 5700XT looks more like a VHS tape, and I can't decide if I like the look of damaged by the courier. Also, it's flimsier than the RX 5700, which is bad, but I can clearly see the direction AMD went, ignoring the looks while focusing on providing the best possible performance. So far, I can't say that I like the new cards with their not-so-cool design and the high TDP, but let's see how this translates into performance. And boy oh boy, it is something. For the tests, I used the same platforms as for the Ryzen CPUs, with the 3900X being the CPU of choice. I tested all games at 3 resolutions, ranging from 1080p to 4K, and used maximum presets. Also, I used the GeForce RTX 2060 Super for comparison. This time around, disabling the RTX settings to provide some fair numbers. As I said earlier, the RX 5700 and the RX 5700XT are some powerhouses offering better performance than they promised in the first place, and this is only for the good of the consumers. I knew that the RX 5700 will be on par with the RTX 2060, but I wasn't expecting it to be similar or better in some cases than the RTX 2060 Super, while the RX 5700XT is getting results similar to the RTX 2070 while costing less than the RTX 2060 Super. In AC Odyssey, tested in 1080p at its highest preset, the 5700XT topped 70fps, while 5700 had an average of 61 and the 2060 Super 64. In Metro Exodus, 5700XT had an average of 65fps against the 5758 of the 5700 and the 2060 Super. But the 5700XT really amazed us in higher resolutions like 1440 and 4K. In Shadow of the Tomb Raider in 1440, 5700XT hit a fabulous 112fps on the highest preset, against 68-69fps provided by the 5700 and the 2060 Super. In 4K in Forza Horizon 4, on the highest preset, both AMD cards topped 70fps, while Nvidia got only 62. AMD went all in with this launch, and man, they nailed it. Both the CPUs and the GPUs offer great price-to-performance figures, and I think they managed to provide the best combo on the market at this moment, with the Ryzen 7 3700X and the Radeon RX 5700XT being the best choices if you want to play the latest and the greatest titles without sacrificing the kidney. I'm curious how Intel and Nvidia will respond to this launch, because both of them are in deep trouble. Probably some price cuts will be beneficial for them, and also for us. It's nice to have good prices and a big selection of hardware to choose from. Okay, what I can promise right now is that we'll test them further. If you enjoyed this video, please subscribe to our young channel and leave your comments below. Thank you very much.